Welcome to the weekly webcast. Each week, these messages are brought to you with practical help for daily living from our teacher and pastor, John S. Torell. Our hope is that you'll be encouraged and challenged by this message and that you'll share it with a friend. Lucifer must have thought that the destruction of Jerusalem and its temple, along with the mass removal of Jews to Babylon, was a failure on the part of the Godhead to bring a Redeemer to the earth. Millions of Israelites had died in their sins, and now only a remnant remained. The situation looked bleak, but God had a secret plan. Daniel, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego had been placed in Babylon a decade earlier so that the Godhead could elevate them within Nebuchadnezzar's government. These four men would go on to shape politics in Babylon and protect their countrymen when they arrived. Now, let's join Pastor John as he begins today's message.
Well, praise the Lord, and welcome to Resurrection Life of Jesus Church Worldwide. And we're going to be talking today about the Jews in Babylon. And this is really an exciting story that, if we really understand it, it's going to help us to live today. So turn in your Bible to Jeremiah chapter 25. So let's pray right now. If you're in a chapel, stand with us. My Heavenly Father, I want to thank you and praise you right now for helping me with this message. I thank you, Father God, my voice is going to hold today. It's not going to give me any problems. I rebuke every demonic entity that is trying to sit here. I rebuke any command center that is operating right now, beaming their stuff in here. In the name of Jesus, I command you shall be destroyed right now. Every entity in there shall be seized and smashed and taken to prison by God's holy angels. Thank you, Father God, for the anointing by the Holy Spirit. And this I ask in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated. Seeing your outline, we read this. The Godhead paused a virtual time run after the slaughter of the Jews in Egypt. The last scene showed Lucifer hovering over Jerusalem with millions of fallen angels and the ground infested with demons dancing around the burned down buildings. Lucifer thought that he had won once and for all over the Godhead, hating or halting their plan to bring a Redeemer to the earth. He boasted that Jerusalem was finally his, and there was great jubilation among his minions. Notice now, the plan of the Redeemer is a bloodline. God called out Abraham and said, through you and your seed, I will have a Redeemer. We got Isaac, we got Jacob, we got the 12 sons of Jacob, and then we got the people of Israel after 400 years in Egypt. They were taken out. Moses brought them out. Joshua brought them into the promised land. Then we had the judges, the time of the kings. And now, the 10 northern tribes, not in existence anymore. Judah reduced to a rubble and only a handful. The temple destroyed. So God simply had seen this. And when it looked like absolutely an impossibility, God had a plan. Regardless of life that we have, God has a plan. There's never a crisis in heaven. God has a solution to every problem. And in due time, he will work it out in our lives. In the book of Jeremiah, chapter 25, we read from verse number 9. Behold, I will send and take all the famine to the north, says the Lord. And Nebuchadnezzar, the king of Babylon, my servant, would bring them against his land, and against the inhabitants thereof, and against all the nations round about, and would utterly destroy them, and make them an astonishment, and a hissing, and a perpetual desolation. Moreover, I will take them from the voice of mirth, and the voice of gladness, the voice of the bridegroom, and the voice of the bride, the sound of the millstone, and the light of the candle. And this whole land shall be a desolation and astonishment. And these nations shall serve the king of Babylon 70 years. God spoke to Jeremiah and said this: you have sinned as a people. It has come to the place right now when I cannot redeem you in this land. I'm going to have the temple destroyed. I have to destroy everything you have, houses. I'm going to have to remove a remnant to go to Babylon. And the people that walked to Babylon was forced marched. They would never return. Their children and grandchildren would. If you turn to Daniel chapter 9, that's the book of Daniel, the 9th chapter, and verses 1 and 2. In the first year of Darius, the son of Ahasuerus, of the seed of the Medes, which was made king over the realm of the Chaldeans, in the first year of his reign, I, Daniel, stood by the books. The number of years whereof the word of the Lord came to Jeremiah the prophet, that he would accomplish 70 years in the desolation of Jerusalem. How was life in Babylon? If you turn to Psalm 137, we will get an understanding of it was when they came there. In Psalms 137, and we pick it up here in verse number 1. By the rivers of Babylon, there we sat down, yea, we wept, for we remembered Zion. We hanged our harps upon the willows in the midst thereof. For there they had carried us away captive, required us a song, and they that wasted us required us mirth, saying, sing us one of the songs of Zion. How shall we sing the Lord's song in a strange land? If I forget you, O Jerusalem, let my right hand forget her cunning. If I do not remember you, let your tongue cleave to the roof of my mouth. If I prefer not Jerusalem by my chief joy. Remember, O Lord, the children of Edom, the day Jerusalem was said, raise it, even to the foundation thereof. O daughter of Babylon, who art to be destroyed, happy shall he be that rewards you as you have served us. Happy shall he be that takes and dashes the little ones against the stones. There was a lot of bitterness. They were simply looking for the destruction of Babylon. On my page number 2 of my outline, it's important to recognize that the adults taken to captivity were old, and the majority of them died during the time of 70 years. Now, God encouraged them in Jeremiah chapter 29. That's Jeremiah, the 29th chapter. We read this from verses 1 through 7. And I'm going to pick it up in verse number 5. Let's start at 4. This is the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel, unto all that are carried away captive, and caused to be carried away from Jerusalem to Babylon. Build your houses, dwell in them, plant gardens, eat the fruit of them. Take your wives and beget sons and daughters, and take wives for your sons, and give your daughters to the husband, that they may bear sons and daughters, that you may be increased there and not diminished. And seek the peace of the city, which I've caused you to be carried away captives, and pray unto the Lord for it. For in the peace thereof you shall have peace. So God simply said this, it's my plan, I'm going to move you there. You're not, that generation is not going to come back. Build houses, plant, start business, be active. You are where I want you to be. It was not God's perfect will to have them in Babylon, but it was God's permissive will. Let me back up on that. God's perfect will was that Israel would have worshipped him. They would not have idols. They would not have killed their children by passing them through the fire. They would have not gone to Baal. If they would have done that, Israel, the 12 tribes, could have been in the land. They could have been blessed to the max. And when Jesus came, he could have come to Israel, where they had the temple, where they were victorious. That was God's plan. That was his perfect plan. But now, people decided, we want to sin. So God said, okay, I have no other choice. I'm going to put you now in my permissive will, Babylon. Lots of people died in that. A lot of people today are in God's permissive will. God is simply chastising you. One disaster after the other is happening. And he's simply saying, listen, come to me. Let's get back into God's restorative will. Now, we have Daniel and his three friends. So turn to the book of Daniel. And I'm going to highlight this. That's Daniel. We're going to go to chapter 1. Daniel was taken in the first wave when they took out, when Nebuchadnezzar came to Jerusalem and took the first group of people out. So Daniel now and his friends were taken to Babylon. Here's what I'm going to say now. God said, you're going to be in Babylon, but I don't want you to be part of Babylon. I'm going to protect you in Babylon. And the way I'm going to protect you is, I'm going to have some of my choice people rise up into government circles and be making sure that there's no persecution, that there's no damage done to my people. In today, where we are now, America is at the crossroads. We have been at it for some time. God really wants to bless us, but he can only bless us if we are obedient. And God needs men like Daniel, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. He's looking for that today. So we read it from Daniel chapter 1, the first five verses. In the third year of the reign of Jehoiakim, king of Judah, came Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, unto Jerusalem, besieged it. And the Lord gave Jehoiakim, king of Judah, into his hand, with part of the vessels of the house of God, which he carried into the land of Shinar in the house of his God. And he brought the vessel into the treasure house of God. Notice it now. The temple in Jerusalem was holy. God had commissioned Solomon to build it. There were all kind of different vessels of gold and silver that was dedicated to God. And God simply says, that means nothing to me. Obedience is a key. I don't care about these holy things. Obedience. And so these holy things were taken into a house of an idol god. And the king spake unto Ashpenaz, the master of the eunuchs, that he should bring certain of the children of Israel, and the king's seed, and other princes, children in whom was no blemish, but well favored, skillful in all wisdom and cunning in knowledge, understanding science, and such that whole had ability in them to stand in the king's palace, whom they might teach the learning and the tongue of the Chaldeans. And the king appointed them a daily provision of the king's meat, of the wine which he drank, so nourish them 3 years, that at the end thereof they might stand before the king. Nebuchadnezzar was smart. He knew this, that education was a key to his kingdom. If he was going to have a strong army, he could have a strong economy, he needed to have educated people. What Nebuchadnezzar did was, when he conquered the different countries, some of the kings he killed off, but most of the kings he took captive. And he brought these kings to Babylon. And they were simply a council for him, because these kings were skilled in warfare and so on. They had wisdom. So Nebuchadnezzar had a group of kings. They were captives. And he simply said, I want you wisdom. I'm going to ask you for advice. He also said this, I'm going to take the smartest children that they have. These were men, they didn't take the women. And I want to educate them, because if I can get educated people, it would help me in my administration and in the army. In verse number 6, now among these were children of Judah, Daniel, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah. And to which the prince of the eunuch gave names, for he gave the name of Belteshazzar, to Hananiah of Shadrach, and Mishael to Meshach, and Azariah to Abednego. So, this was done now to simply integrate them. Simply, okay, you're not going to have Jewish names anymore. You're going to have Chaldean names. But Daniel purposed in his heart that he would not defile himself with a portion of the king's meat, nor with the wine which he drank. Therefore he requested the prince of the eunuch that he might not defile himself. What did Daniel do here in these three fronts? They had read the Torah, the five books of Moses. They knew Leviticus chapter 11 talked about food. And there were food laws. Food laws were not given for salvation. They were given so you have better health, longer life, but also an act of obedience. Now, picture this. Here's Daniel now. He's a captive. And they say, okay, we got some pork here. We got crawdads. We got all kind of different goodies here, you know. And Daniel said, now, I'm going to risk my life I'm going to ask. I don't want to eat this. The king could have simply ordered, take that guy out and cut him head off. But look down verse number 9. Now God had brought Daniel into favor and tender love with the prince of the eunuchs. God moved upon a heathen, a castrated man, and simply said, he put love in, and this man had compassion. He liked Daniel. If you can understand now, God can do anything. God will do whatever he wants. So when you are in life and you simply say, well, how is this going to work out? God can take a person who's in charge of you. He can take someone working in the government and simply put love in that man. And he simply says, you know, I like this person over here. I like that person. I really want to help them out. So remember this. God can, God will, and he does whatever he wants to make the job possible. And the prince of the eunuchs said to Daniel, I fear, my lord, the king has appointed you meat and you drink. For why should he see your faces worse like in the children which are of your sort? Then shall you make me endanger my head to the king. He said, okay, Daniel, this is fine. But you know what you're asking me? If I don't feed you properly and you get skinny, the king is going to say, hey, he's going to ask my head. He's going to cut my head off. Then said Daniel to Melzar, whom the prince of the eunuchs had set over Daniel, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah, prove your servants, I beseech you, 10 days. Let them give us pulse or simply green stuff, salads. Let them give us salads to eat and water to drink. Then let our countenance be looked upon before you, and the count of the children that are the portion of the king's meat, and as you see, deal with your servants. Daniel said, fine, I understand that. Give God 10 days. Let God prove it for 10 days. So he consented to them in the matter and proved them 10 days. This is where our faith comes in. I talk to people and says, well, you know, we don't have the money. I'm sick, we can't do this, we can't do that, you know, it's not working out. What's wrong with us? God can do whatever he wants. He is unlimited. Absolutely unlimited. And he simply looked upon us and said, you know, you're not very smart. Why do you limit me? Trust God. I tell people this. Trust God in other people. Trust Jesus in them. Believe that Jesus can change things. He will. At the end of the 10 days, the countess appeared fairer, fatter in the flesh than all the other children did eat the portion of the king's meat. So God gave a miracle. Will God give miracles today? Absolutely. Thus Melzer took away the portion of their meat and the wine that they should drink and gave them pulse, so he gave simply everyone a vegetarian diet. That doesn't mean that we have to be vegetarians, but there was no meat, because all meat in Babylon was contaminated. It was simply slaughtered, and in the temple areas, it was dedicated to an idol, and they usually had pork, they had pigs, they had all kind of different animals. It was contaminated. And so in this case, they became vegetarians. As for the four children, God gave them knowledge and skill in all learning and wisdom, and Daniel had understanding in all visions and dreams. I might be slow in this sermon here today. Who was Daniel? Daniel was a baby boy that was born. We don't even know his mother's name, his dad's name. He was born in a time of war, trouble. As a teenager, he was growing up in Jerusalem with a lot of idolatry. Babylonians on the outside, always war. But God simply, before the foundation of the world, has said, now, I'm going to create a human being with a soul, and I'm going to create him powerful. Daniel believed in God. He was saved, so to say, before the cross. And God simply said, I'm going to build this guy up to be a powerhouse. Did Daniel do it to himself? No. It was put into him. And then God simply said, I'm going to use him. I'm going to use his three friends. And they are going to rise in the government in Babylon. They're going to sit there as Jews, as God's people. Not necessarily Jews or God people, but they're going to be there as the seed of Abraham. And they are going to make sure that my people are safe. So, when you see a baby that is born and you see children, you do not know what God's going to do. God is going to take a number of children, and they're going to do outstanding things in the future. So, at the same time, the enemy knows that, so he will also hit us hard. Now, at the end of the days that the king had said that he should bring them in, the prince of the eunuchs brought them in before Nebuchadnezzar. This is like a graduation. Think about this now. Probably Daniel was probably about maybe 20 years old. He and his friend now come in. Here sits the king and his advisor and all the royal court and everything else. And in walks now four young Jewish men. And they're going to be examined. It's going to be an oral examination. And the king communed with them. And among them all was found not like Daniel, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah. Therefore stood they before the king. And in all matters of wisdom and understanding that the king inquired of them, he found them 10 times better than all the magicians and astrologers that were in his realm. And Daniel continued even unto the first year of King Cyrus. So God now simply said this, I am going to move them into government positions. But he didn't want them just to be in government positions. He wanted them to be at the top. And so in Daniel chapter 2, we had this here in the verse number 1, in the second year of the reign of Nebuchadnezzar. Nebuchadnezzar dreamed dreams where his spirit was troubled and his sleep break from him. And the king commanded to call the magicians and the astrologers, the sorcerers and the Chaldeans, for to show the king his dreams. So they came and stood before the king. And the king said to them, I have dreamt a dream, My spirit was troubled, and to know the dream. Then spake the Chaldeans to the king in Syriac, O king, live forever. Tell your servant the dream, and we will show you the interpretation. The king answered and said to the Chaldeans, the thing is gone from me. I can't remember the dream. If you will make me known unto me the dream, with interpretation of, if you don't do that, you shall be cut in pieces, your houses shall be made a dunghill. But if you show the dream and interpretation of, you shall receive of me gifts and rewards and great honor, therefore show me the dream and interpretation thereof. Then they answered again and said, let the king tell his servants the dream, and we will show the interpretation of it. The king answered and said, I know of certainty that you would gain the time, because you see the thing is gone from me. But if you will not make known unto me the dream, there is but one decree for you. For you have prepared lying and corrupt words to speak before me, till the time be changed. Therefore tell me the dream, and I shall know that you can show me the interpretation thereof. The Chaldeans answered before the king and said, there is not a man upon the earth that can show the king's matter. Therefore there is no king, lord, nor ruler that asks a thing of any magician or astrologer or Chaldean. Verse 12, for this cause the king was angry, was furious, and commanded to destroy all the wise men of Babylon. Later on in the chapter now, we go down to verse number 16. Daniel got word, he was part of this group, and he was told, hey, we're going to be all chopped, we're going to have our heads chopped off. In verse 16, then Daniel went in and desired the king that he would give him time, that he would show the king the interpretation. Then Daniel went to his house and made the king known to Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah, his companions, that they would desire mercies of God of heaven concerning this secret, that Daniel's fellow should not perish with the rest of the wise men of Babylon. Picture yourself in a situation now. Somebody come up to you and say, I had a dream. Oh, that's nice. I want to interpret the dream. Okay, what's a dream? I can't remember. But, you know, I want you to, first of all, be able to find out what the dream was and interpret it. Now, outside the Holy Spirit, you can't do that. So the Chaldeans and the magicians simply said, you know, we don't have that power. Satan does not give that power. He doesn't have that power. I want you to see the faith now. Daniel, they've been sentenced to death. Daniel asked for the king, can I see you? He walks into the king and said, now, give me time. Let me talk to my God. That's faith. You know what I found out? People don't like to dance on this side of what they call the Red Sea, or the sea that the people of Israel crossed. When they came up to the water, they murmured, said, Moses, what's wrong with you? We should have stayed in Egypt. We got the garlic, we got the leeks, we got the food, we got all that stuff. Moses, you are crazy. We don't like you. And Moses said, stand still. Now, did they dance on that side of the waters? No. When did they dance? After they had seen the miracle. The strongest thing that you can do in the spirit world is when you have cancer, you got diabetes, you got a disease, and you're simply saying, God, I thank you, I'm going to be healed. I thank my healing, and I'm going to start dancing now. I haven't seen it yet, but I'm going to start dancing now and sing and praise you. That brings a tremendous victory. But most people, they simply moan and groan, and then God delivers them, and I say, oh, praise God, he did deliver me. And God said, what do you think I did? I want to do that. So Daniel now went to his house. He talked to his friends, and they prayed. He simply said, God, I believe you brought me to Babylon. I believe that you raised me up. I am in government official right now. I believe that you are going to continue. You're not going to drop me now. Verse 18. Then they would desire mercies of the God of heaven concerning the secret, that Daniel's fellow should not perish with the rest of the wise men of Babylon. Then was a secret revealed unto Daniel night vision. Then Daniel blessed the God of heaven. Daniel answered and said, blessed be the name of God forever and ever, for wisdom and might are his. And he changes the times and the seasons. He removes kingdoms, sets up kings. He gives wisdom unto the wise and knowledge to them that understand. He reveals a deep and secret thing. He knows what is in the darkness, and the light dwells with him. I thank you and praise you, O you God of my fathers, who has given me wisdom and might, has made known unto me now what we desired of you, for you have now made known unto us the king's matter. Notice now the attributes that Daniel put on God. How much he's told him now, that you are great, you can do this, you can do all kind of things. Yet, Daniel now had not been to the king yet. He had been given a vision. But I'm sure the devil said, you know, Daniel, how do you know that's a dream? Let me back up. Listen to me now. Daniel got the dream. He got the understanding. He had not been to the king. The devil said, would have told him this. I don't think that who you got the revelation is true. You're going to fail, Daniel. You're going to tell this to the king, and the king said, no, that's not what I dreamt. This is where your faith comes in, and this is where people simply lose it. God tells you something. He says, run with it. But the devil comes in and says, no, that was not God speaking to you. Oh, that's not going to happen. And so we lose it. Daniel walked in, simply said, king, here I am. Here's the deal. This is your dream. This is what it means. The result, same chapter, now we go to the end. Verse 47. The king answered unto Daniel and said, of a truth it is, that your God is a God of gods, and the Lord of kings, reveal our secret, seeing you could reveal the secret. Then the king made Daniel a great man, gave him many great gifts, made him ruler over the whole province of Babylon, chief of the governors over all the wise men of Babylon. Then Daniel requested in the king, and he set Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego over the affairs of the province of Babylon. But Daniel sat in the gate of the king. Anytime you read gate, it doesn't mean that you have some kind of a gate going someplace. Gate means courthouse. It meant Daniel sat in the palace, in the courtroom, where the king was ruling. He sat there with the king. He was second in command. He asked now, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, they became governors in the Babylonian city area. They were now at the top. How did they get there? Because they believed God. God simply said, this is what I want. These are the people I created. But Daniel and his three friends had to have faith. If Daniel would have said, like Moses did, Moses said, who am I? I can't speak. They don't believe me. Moses didn't move until God got angry. And that's what I see with you and I today. God has great things for us to do. We don't believe it. We moan and groan. And we say, oh, well, you know, it's not working. It doesn't matter if the Antichrist is coming. It doesn't matter if things are bleak. God is going to have his people. There's going to be a move of the Holy Spirit. It might not be like in the older days that I had, but he's going to move and do things. So, God simply elevated them up. If we go now to chapter, we read chapter 2 here now, so I'm going to go now to page number 3 on my outline. So, we got politics now. You're already going to have politics. And in Daniel chapter 3, we now had that Satan simply said, this is not working out for me. So, he took Nebuchadnezzar, spun his head around. He probably had advisors saying, you know, hey, we got a lot of gold. We took all the gold in Jerusalem. We got gold from this place and that place. Let's make a statue and have people worship that statue. The king said, okay. They set up a statue, 90 feet tall, made of gold. And the people were told that when you hear the singers and the musicians started to singing, drop to your knees, get your hands up, and worship this statue. Well, there was three guys. Daniel was not part of this group. So in verse number 8 of that chapter, where for the time certain Chaldeans came near and accused the Jews. They spake and said to the king Nebuchadnezzar, O king, live forever. That's flattery, because he knows he's not going to live forever. He's going to die. His soul is going to live forever. You, O king, hath made a decree that every man that shall hear the sound of the cornet, the flute, the harp, sackbut, psaltery, and dulcimer, and all kind of music, shall fall down and worship the golden image. Whosoever falls not down and worships, that he shall be cast in the midst of the burning fire furnace. There are certain Jews whom you have set over the affairs of the province of Babylon. There's certain Jews here. They are in charge. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. These men, O king, have not regarded you. They serve not your gods, nor worship the golden image which you have set up. Well, Nebuchadnezzar, no, he got angry. He says, no one crosses me. So they brought Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego to him. He spoke to them and said, is it true, O Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego? Do you not serve my gods, nor worship the golden image I have set up? Now, if you be ready, that at what time you hear the sound of the cornet, flute, harp, sackbut, psaltery, dulcimer, all kind of music, you fall down and worship the image which I made, well, but if you worship not, you'll be cast in the same hour into the midst of the burning fire furnace. And who is that God that shall deliver you out of my hands? Now, here are these three guys. So how did they answer? They said to the king, O Nebuchadnezzar, we are not careful to answer you this matter. But in other words, we are not going to sit here and think about it a long time. We're going to give it to you. But if not, he said this, If it be so, our God whom we serve is able to deliver us from the burning fire furnace. He will deliver us out of your hand, O king. But if not, be it known unto you, O king, that we will not serve your gods nor worship the golden image which you have set up. Some of you might have to experience this in the coming of the Antichrist. But you're told, you know, that you have the mark of the beast here, and if not, you know, you're gonna be put out to the pastures. And so these three men simply said, if God delivers us, fine. If he does not deliver us, fine. Why? Because they believed in a life after death. They were concerned about eternity. They were not concerned about the now and here. So what happened? Well, the story's been over that many times, that they simply were thrown in there. Jesus showed up, and Nebuchadnezzar said, we threw down three guys, there are four guys in there. Well, that was Jesus. He called them out, and he found out that they were not in any way or shape hurt. In verse 29, we read this. Nebuchadnezzar said this. Therefore, I make a decree that every people, nation, and language which speak anything amiss against the God of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego shall be cut in pieces. Their house shall be made a dunghill, because there is no other God that can deliver after this matter. Notice that. Because there is no other God that can deliver after this sort. Then the king promoted Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego in the province of Babylon. They rose even higher. So, God now simply had things where he wanted to be. But he was not done. In chapter 4 of Daniel, we had another dream that Nebuchadnezzar had. And Daniel interpreted it. And Nebuchadnezzar was warned, don't brag. Give glory to God. God put you on the throne, man. And we notice that in that chapter, we get to the last part of it. In verse 29, at the end of 12 months, God gave him a year. He had, again, he walked in the palace of the kingdom of Babylon. Then the king spake and said, is not this the great Babylon that I have built for the house of the kingdom by the might of my power and for the honor of my majesty? While the word was in the king's mouth, there fell a voice from heaven saying, O King Nebuchadnezzar, to you is spoken, the kingdom is departed from you. You read the rest of the chapter, he became mentally ill. He simply walked like a beast, talked like a beast. They didn't kill him. They put him out to the pasture. He was in the grass, living down there for a season. And then, in verse 34, and at the end of the days, I, Nebuchadnezzar, lifted up my eyes unto heaven. My understanding returned unto me, and I blessed the Most High, and I praised and honored him that lives forever, whose dominion is an everlasting dominion. His kingdom is from generation to generation. And all inhabitants of the earth are reputed as nothing. He does according to his will in the army of heaven, among the inhabitants of the earth, and none can stay his hand or say to him, what are you doing? And at the same time, reason returned to me, and for the glory of my kingdom, my honor and brightness returned to me, and my counsel, my Lord, sought unto me. I was established in my kingdom, and excellent majesty was added unto me. Now, I, Nebuchadnezzar, praise and extol and honor the King of heaven, all whose works are truth, and his way judgment, and those that walk in pride, he is able to abase. The book of Daniel is crucial. It is a prophetic book. It's also a book that tells us what happened to the people, the Jews, that were taken to Babylon. In the 1800s, we have what they call German theologians. And there's a batch of them. They got kind of strange names. And they begin what they called a higher revelation, higher criticism. And Satan had these men, and they declared that the book of Daniel is forgery. Daniel never existed. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego never existed. Eventually, it got into the churches, slowly, and by the 1950s, every seminary in America, if it was a Baptist, Presbyterian, Methodist, whatever they were, they all have agreed upon the book of Daniel is forgery. If you go on the internet and you simply look up the book of Daniel, you're going to find that that's exactly what they're telling you on the internet. That's the version, that's what I call the satanic version. Is the book of Daniel true? To me, absolutely yes. I was in the seminary my first year, and I had not really heard this before. And one day as I walked into the lobby, I found 25-30 boxes sitting in the lobby. And I said, what's this? They said, well, this is the book that Pastor Criswell has written. He was from Dallas, First Baptist Church in Dallas, Texas. And the book was called Daniel in the Critic's Den. And he had purchased, he'd written the book. They sent it to all six seminaries at that time, and he demanded that the book be handed out to every seminary student. And it was in defense of the book of Daniel. He proved a beyond description that the book of Daniel is as real as it says. Today, you go to the average pastor, he's going to say, well, I don't really preach out of Daniel because, you know, it's a forgery, it's not true. What are they telling you? Here's a story. About 150 years before Christ, the Jews were fighting and they were having problems. So a couple of guys sat down and wrote the book of Daniel in order to build morale among the Jews who were fighting the Greeks and others at that time. That's why they wrote. So now you have these very scholastic people, 300 years or 400 years after Daniel, writing the story. And they simply said Daniel never existed. What does that do to us? If you don't accept the book of Daniel as the word of God, you're toast. What I mean by that is, it's not going to change God, but it's going to destroy your faith. It's going to relegate you to a person that simply says, I don't know about this, I don't know about that. You simply have to accept it. Page number 3, I said this. We had this on the vision. Then we have Nebuchadnezzar died. We had his son, King Amel-Marduk, became the next king. He didn't last too long. He was murdered. Then we had this Nergal-Sharezer. He was a general, and he took him out, and then he died. And then we got Labash-Marduk. He lasted about three months. And that's as far we're going to take the Babylonian captivity today. You can see here on the chart how these different kings came in. But the summary is what I want to share with you now is simply this. And this is what I want to hammer in. This is a story. You understand this? Abraham was instructed by God to move from the Chaldean city of Ur to the land of Canaan. That's a fact. Isaac was born and raised in Canaan. He was a caretaker. Jacob's family from 70 persons moved to Egypt under the provincial leadership of Joseph. That's a fact. During the 400 years in Egypt, the family of 12 brothers grew to a nation of some 3 million people. Moses relocated them through a series of miracles to the wilderness west of Egypt. They learned about faith and obedience during this 40-year period. Joshua led a military campaign and brought in the promised land. That's where it all had begun with Abraham. God led the people with judges until they complained and wanted the king like other nations. And then the last page. The majority of the kings were evil and brought the divine judgment upon the people. The exodus from Egypt was an amazing victory that saw God defeat Pharaoh and his army was the exile to Babylon was forced march under the guard of the Babylonian army. The protection of the remnant in Babylon was accomplished through Daniel and others who rose to prominence in the government of Babylon. What will it do to you as an individual? Here's what I want you to take home with today. God judged Judah, put him into captivity. But God simply said, you're going to be there for 70 years. I'm going to protect you. I'm going to preserve you. And in time, I'm going to bring you back. I'm going to bring a remnant back. When the Redeemer comes, there will be a temple in Jerusalem. When the Redeemer comes, there will be a Jewish population in Israel, Judah, Galilee, and Samaria. That's what God said. God made it possible. So in your life, you are not an accident. God has a plan for your life. He simply says this now. Don't listen to this prophet over here. And don't listen to this guy over here. And yes, things are bad. This is happening. Everything is falling apart. The money is going to fail. Banks are going to close. Everything is coming down. Well, eventually it will. Because the Antichrist cannot come unless there is chaos. But we're not there yet. And even in the chaos, God will use his people. We can have victory. We can have victory over our diseases. We can have victory in financial matters. We can have victory in anything we want. But the thing that hangs you up is faith. Do you have faith in God? My closing scripture is a bonus scripture is found in the book of Hebrews. And I quoted it many, many times. Hebrews chapter 11. And we pick it up in verse number 6. But without faith, it's impossible to please him. For he that comes to God must believe that he is. He's a rewarder of them that diligently seek him. That verse was hammered home to me about 1972. We had a man that was part of our ministry. His name was Chester. He's gone with the Lord now. And Chester owned a service station in the city of Stockton. And one day we were visiting in town, we had a revival there, so I went over to his service station to talk to him. And so we were standing there outside the pumps, at two rows of pumps. And a guy drove up. And he said, "Sir, can you tell me where this street is?" This is before we had GPSs. And Chester said, "Yeah, sure, I can do that." So Chester told him, "You do this, this, and this, and that." And the man looked at him and said, "Are you sure?" And Chester said, "No, I'm not sure." And you know what he did? He sent him in the opposite direction, 180 degrees off. I had to stand there. And after the guy left, going in the wrong direction, I said, "Chester, why did you do that?" He said, "That guy didn't believe that I told him the truth." He said, "That just made me mad. I mean, I told the guy the truth. He didn't believe it. So now I punished him. He's going to go in the tulips and he's going to be lost for a while." And I thought about, that's what God said here, you know. But without faith, it's impossible to please him. For he that comes to God must believe that he is. He's a rewarder of them that diligently seek him. So, in order for you to have the faith, you got to come to the place where you realize, I'm going to believe God. I'm sick. I don't have money. Nothing is working out. I just got divorce papers. I lost my business. And that's when you stand and say, "God, I trust in you. This is going to work out, one half way or the other. I'm not going to worry about the details. I'm going to focus on you. I'm going to put my trust in you. I'm going to be praising you on this side of the waters. And I'm going to have victory." Those are the people that get victory. But those that says, "Well, I'm not too sure that God will do that." I tell you what, if Chester sent that guy to Timbuktu, God will do the same thing. He would simply say, "Okay, you don't believe me? I'll let you walk around a little bit in the wilderness. And when you're tired of the wilderness, come on back and we will have a talk." That's the bottom line. So you watch me today. You're not saved. And you said, "Well, you kind of funny preacher." Yes, I'm a funny preacher. I'm a crazy preacher. I've been called crazy. I don't know what I'm doing. But here's a thing you can do that is crazy for the world, but good for you. Acknowledge that you're a sinner. Step one. That's easy. Number two, simply say, "I believe that Jesus is the Son of God. I believe that Jesus died on the cross, rose on the third day, and he paid for my sins on the cross. Jesus, I accept that. Forgive me. Come into my life. Save me right now." And he will. When we finish here after our last prayer, the screen will change. Three crosses would come up. You would hear the voice of Charles Torell, Pastor Charles Torell. And he would say, "My friend," and he would take you through the plan of salvation again, but detailing it for you with scriptures, praying with you, so you can make sure that today your name will be in the book of life. When you do that, contact us. We would like to rejoice with you. Pray with you on the phone. Send you something that we can encourage you with. And to those of you that are Christians, and I say again, some of you are up here, some of you are down here, and then I got people all the way between. Just ask yourself this. If I would have been a Daniel, if I would have been in Babylon, what would I have done? Well, you're in Babylon here. This is Babylon. Things are bad. Things are going to get worse. But God's still on the throne. And are you going to begin to believe and say, "God, I'm going to believe that you're going to get me out of this jam. You're going to heal me. You're going to take care of me. You're going to do whatever you need to do. Listen to this sermon again. It's going to be replayed. Read the outline again this afternoon. And then change. Don't be like this. Somebody asked you afterwards, how was the sermon today? Great. What was it about? I don't know, but it was great. Well, in order for you to understand what the sermon was, you've got to go home, you've got to read the outline. That's what we give you, an outline. You can read that. So with that, God bless you. I love you. I want to be fussing with you. Here's Thomas.
So, Chester, I like your style. I want to say happy Mother's Day to all the mothers, because they deserve honor. It ain't easy being a mother. So thank God for mothers. And when it comes to the book of Daniel, I like hearing it time and time again. It's like my wife will say to me, well, haven't you seen that movie about 30 times? You know, like Patton or The Bridge on the River Kwai. And I say, yeah, but I'm going to watch it again. So the book of Daniel, I never get tired of hearing about it. So, Father God, thank you for the word. And I thank you for the book of Daniel. And I thank you for the men that stood and would not bow the knee. And I thank you for that great example, Lord. And I believe you're raising up a remnant that is going to be of the same caliber. They're not going to bow the knee. And I thank you for that. Thank you for your blessing upon those that took the time today to attend church, to hear the word, and to set aside that time. I also want to lift up one of our men that works for us, named Joshua Gilbert, Lord. And he suffered an injury this week, and he's basically out of commission for a little while. Sometimes that happens. It's happened to me in the past, where you can use that time to, do the things that you should have done. Take time to find out who God is, what His plan is for your life, things like that. I lift up Joshua to you, and I ththank you, Father God, for leading him and guiding him, and also, Lord, for healing, that he will be restored, but that he will take this time on the side to seek diligently after you. And I thank you for this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Hello there, friend. You might have some questions about Christianity. There are many so-called Christian churches out there. So what makes a person a Christian? How do you get right with God? And how do you know when you die that you'll go to heaven? How exactly does a person get to heaven? Does God have a standard? And if so, what is it? What I'm about to tell you will be the most important information you will ever hear on this earth. And your decision will determine how you spend eternity. As you continue listening, I will explain. The bad news is this. When we are born into this world, we are automatically born with sin. Now you might think of yourself as a good person. After all, you're nice to other people, you give money to charity, and you try to live a good life. However, everyone has sinned and fallen short of God's standard. So it doesn't matter how moral, religious, or philosophical you are, you've broken God's commandments, and that has separated you from God. The Bible says in Romans 3:23, "For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God." Now you might say, Well, I'm a good person. Doesn't that count for something? Okay, let's take a little test. I'm going to ask you 3 questions. 1. Have you ever told a lie? 2. Have you ever stolen anything? Even something insignificant like a paperclip at work? 3. Have you ever lusted after someone of the opposite sex? Okay, how did you do? Most likely you answered yes to all 3 questions, which means you just failed the test. You see, these 3 questions are but 3 of God's 10 commandments. Failing just 1 commandment disqualifies you from getting into heaven and has condemned you to hell. This is why the Bible says in Romans 6:23, "For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord." You see, God knows that we are all guilty of breaking His commandments. That's why He said we've all sinned and fallen short of His standard. But you don't have to be depressed about this. I do have some good news to share with you. In Romans 5:7 through 8, it says, "For scarcely for a righteous man will one die, yet peradventure for a good man some would even dare to die. But God commends His love toward us in that, while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us." You see, God loves you so much that He gave His only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, to pay for the sin in your life. Jesus was more than just a good man. He was God becoming man and walking among us. That is why Jesus died on the cross. He took your place and paid for your sins with His shed blood, so that you can have everlasting life. God loves you so much that He sent His own Son to pay a debt He did not owe, because you owe a debt you could not pay. Jesus bridged the gap created by sin between you and God. The Bible says in John 3:16, "For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in Him should not perish, but have everlasting life." You see, there are 3 places we can exist in this universe: earth, heaven, and hell. So when we die here on earth, we don't just cease to exist. We will step out of our physical bodies and go to one of 2 places, heaven or hell. God did not send His Son to condemn you, but that through Jesus you might be saved and have eternal life in heaven. God's free gift to you is eternal life through His Son, Jesus Christ. That is why Jesus said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father but by me." You see, God offers His love to you through Jesus, even though you are a sinner. This unmerited grace is not something you can buy or earn, but a gift from God. As you're listening right now and realize you're a sinner, know that God loves you and wants to save you. All you need to do is repent of your sins and ask God to forgive you. The word repent means to change your direction. You've been running away from God. Now it's time to start running toward Him. The Bible says in Psalms 103:12, "As far as the east is from the west, so far has He removed our transgressions from us." That means if you call out to God and confess your sins, He will forgive you. What Jesus has done in the past for others, He will do for you. If you call out to Him, He will answer you. He won't look down upon you because of your past, and there isn't a sin so great that it can't be forgiven. All He wants for you is to come to Him. He will help anybody who calls out to Him. If you have sin in your life, God still loves you. If you ask God to save you, He will do so. It is important to remember that talking to God can be done anywhere and anytime. You don't have to be in church to talk to God. He will meet you wherever you are. As you're listening to me right now, if you feel a conviction of sin in your life, that is God's Holy Spirit moving upon you. Friend, you need to repent of your sins right now and call out to Jesus. You might not get another chance. The Bible says, "Today is the day of salvation." Friend, you need to make a decision today, one that will affect you for eternity. You have a choice. The road to hell is paved with good intentions, so act today. I would like to lead you in a prayer right now where you can ask Jesus Christ to come into your life and be your personal Lord and Savior. Now you might ask, what you just said, exactly what does that mean? Well, if you want to start anew and have your sins forgiven, Jesus is the way. There is no other way to God than through Jesus. I'm not talking about being religious. I'm talking about having a personal relationship with the God of creation who loves you so much and is just waiting for you to reach out to Him. That is what I mean by asking Jesus to come into your life and save you. Won't you pray with me right now? God, I confess that I am a sinner and that I need to be saved from my sins. Jesus, I ask that you would forgive me of my sins. I turn from them now and I put my faith in you. Come into my life and be my Lord and Savior. I believe that you paid for my sins on the cross through your shed blood, and that you died for me and rose from the grave. Save me, Jesus. I know I can't save myself. Thank you for saving me and giving me eternal life and a place in heaven with you. Help me to be obedient and to walk with you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. If you just prayed with me and asked Jesus to save you, you are now a Christian. You have become born again and are a new creation in God's eyes. The Bible says in Romans 10:13, "For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved." You see, you're not saved because you might feel saved, but because you have called upon God and He has saved you. Now, as a way to grow closer to Him, the Bible tells you to follow up on your commitment. Spend time with God each day. It doesn't have to be a long period of time. Just develop a daily habit of talking with Him and reading the Bible. Ask God to increase your faith and understanding of the Bible. Also, find a local church where you can worship God and seek fellowship with other Christians to answer your questions and support you. Be sure they use a King James Bible if you live in an English-speaking country, and that the pastor teaches out of the Bible. Plus, don't forget to share your new faith in Jesus with somebody else. After all, if I didn't make this recording to share with you, how would you have heard the good news? Finally, please contact us and tell us about your decision. We will send you some written material that will help you in your new walk with Jesus. This is Charles Torell with European American Evangelistic Crusades. May you grow in grace and in the knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. To Him be glory both now and forever.
You've been listening to the weekly webcast of Pastor John S. Torell. This message was the 68th part in the series, The Origin Story of Jesus, and was entitled, The Jews in Babylon. Lucifer must have thought that the destruction of Jerusalem and the forced removal of Jews to Babylon had effectively destroyed the Godhead's plans to bring a Redeemer to the earth. After all, millions of Israelites had died in their sins, and now there was only a remnant. The situation was bleak, but God had a secret plan. Daniel, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah had been placed in Babylon 10 years earlier when King Jehoiakim was taken into captivity. The Godhead intended to elevate them to the highest echelons of Nebuchadnezzar's government. These four men were given supernatural insight and revelations to interpret the king's dreams and survive life-threatening circumstances through a series of miracles. A decade later, Belteshazzar, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego were in place according to God's plan, ready to shape politics in Babylon and protect their countrymen when they arrived. This message is available on CD and DVD. When ordering, ask for sermon number 1859. There are several ways to contact our ministry. You can visit our website at eaec.org. There you can read insightful articles, watch or listen to a sermon broadcast, and explore the online store. The web address once again is eaec.org. If you prefer to write, address your envelope to European American Evangelistic Crusades, Post Office Box 166, Sheridan, California, 95681. That's Post Office Box 166, Sheridan, California, 95681. If you prefer to call us, the number is 916-944-3724. That's 916-944-3724. Resurrection Life of Jesus Church is sponsored by European American Evangelistic Crusades, and this has been a production of EAEC. Thanks for joining us today, and until next time, may God richly bless you as you read your Bible and walk with Him.